This is Radio Ecoshock with Alex Smith.
We are living in a time of mass extinction of species, large and small. How serious is that? What are the rules of extinction? Two scientists, Italian and Australian, investigated that. Their study, published in Nature November 2018, contains unpleasant surprises. Our guest is Dr. Corey Bradshaw. He is the Matthew Flinders Fellow in Global Ecology at Flinders University in South Australia. Corey has published at least 300 papers and 3 books. His latest is The Effective Scientist, A Handy Guide to a Successful Academic Career. That's published by Cambridge University Press in March 2018. From Adelaide, Corey Bradshaw, welcome to Radio Ecoshock.
Thank you for having me.
Looking over your past papers, extinction is not a new subject for you. What stimulated you and Giovanni Strona to investigate biological collapse in your recent paper?
There's actually an interesting story behind this paper that probably escaped most people's attention. So what happened was we were going through our normal sort of daily routines a couple of years ago and came across a paper that had just been published in the same journal, in fact, Scientific Reports, which is a Nature journal, that said that the Earth can take a lot of shocks. And yes, you might lose a lot of species, but there are a few species out there that are what we call extremophiles, and they can live in extreme environments that would kill most other beings. So you can think of things like the deep vent giant worms that grow on the bottom of the seafloor at sort of places like the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, or you can think about certain types of bacteria. But there's one species in particular that is, I guess, a bit notorious for its ability to be an extremophile, and those are tardigrades. The tardigrades are, for most people who might not know that word, the little water bears is a common name in English. They're more or less microscopic animals that tend to live in the soil. They're beautiful animals. They're bizarre-looking things. They kind of look cute and cuddly when you put them under a microscope. They don't really have a jaw. They have this sort of circular aperture that with teeth-like structures around it, and they have these little hook claws and a fat little squishy body. They're very cute. But what these things can do is they can desiccate, that is, dry out. They can be exposed to extreme heat or extreme cold. You can even shoot them into space, and they can survive. So the authors of this particular paper took these, what we call thermal tolerances, these temperature, the ability to withstand extreme temperatures, and tested what these tardigrades were able to do. And it's true, you can put them through all sorts of horrible conditions, and they can survive. So their conclusion was that the Earth could, be hit by a meteor or go through a nuclear winter or heat up by, 50 degrees, and you'd still have tardigrades around. Everything else would be gone, but tardigrades would still be around. Now, that's interesting if you look simply from the physiological perspective, but as an ecologist, and several of my colleagues, including Giovanni, said, well, this is a bit ridiculous because tardigrades don't live in a vacuum. They have to eat things, and they have to survive within ecosystems, right? So we said, well, what would be the kinds of extinction rates that one might expect if we did what we should do is link all of the species together in what we call food webs or these networks, these ecological networks. So who eats whom? Or you can add more things than just the eating component. You can think of things like competition or pollination. So species depend on each other. Predators depend on their prey. Flowering plants depend on their pollinators and so on and so forth. And so we basically decided to generate these virtual Earths, to use computers to, obviously it's a simplification to a certain extent because we can't model every species on the planet, but we did create virtual Earths that had the same kind of characteristics as ecosystems do today. And when we pushed the system towards a heating event or towards a cooling event, so the heating event's, synonymous with things like climate change, or cooling could be something like an asteroid hitting us and going into kind of a nuclear winter scenario. When you did this, we looked at the extinction rates simply from species dropping off the perch as they exceeded these thermal tolerances, these thresholds of maximum or minimum temperature. And then we also looked at what the extinctions would be if the so-called extinction cascades were taken into account. So if you lose, for example, a prey species, then the predator would go extinct, and so on and so forth. And it had all sorts of issues about dispersal and adaptation and competition and so on and so forth. We also had latitudinal gradients like a real Earth. And we did thousands and thousands of these Earths in different iterations. When we did this, it turns out that the extinction rate including the extinction cascades, actually were about 10 times higher than what you'd expect simply from the warming or the cooling.
And that key concept which you bring out in the paper is called co-extinction, is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. So co-extinction just means that if one thing goes extinct, there are going to be other things that depend on it that go extinct. So that's the co-extinction or the extinction cascade.
Right, and I think that in previous studies and in all of our minds, we think, well, we could just study the upper tolerance for heat by carrying some plant or animal inside and turning up the thermostat and seeing when they fail to reproduce or just die. But that isn't going to work because of the very reasons you just described.
Exactly. And, you know, it's pretty basic stuff, really, for ecologists. But for most other people don't actually consider those linkages. It did come a bit of a shock. But I'll tell you this right now. That paper shocked me. Now, I get bad news every day. The world is in an extinction spiral right now. Environmental degradation is happening across the board. And I'm not just talking about climate change. I'm talking about deforestation and pollution and feral species, invasive species, the loss of insects. The list goes on. Climate change is a very strong stressor in a system that's already highly stressed. But when we did this paper, I had to sit back and go, wow, I did not expect it to be this bad. Now, there's even a scarier story in all this. It's not just the fact that the extinction rates are probably 10 times underestimated if we just look at the thermal tolerances. If we take those networks now, and this is what we did also in the paper, and you deliberately pretend to be a super being and try to make the system go extinct as fast as possible. So what we did here was we just took the most important species in the network, which are generally the ones that are more connected in the network, so they influence more species. And we take the most connected node in this network, species, and we make that go extinct. Now, these are computer experiments, obviously. This isn't in the real world. And then we take the second most important species, and we knock that out. And then we take the third most, and so on and so on, so forth. We can then compare that to a sort of a random extinction process where we just take nodes out at random, or we can then look at the extreme cold or the extreme warming scenarios. And as it turns out, the warming scenario mimicked almost exactly the worst-case scenario where we knocked out the most important species first. In other words, warming is pretty much the worst thing that can happen to an ecosystem. And that kind of follows what we've been finding, and I do a lot of paleo work as well, so looking at extinctions of mammoths and diprotodons in Australia and various things over the last, you know, several hundred thousand years. And what's coming out is it's not the cold events, it's the warm events that are causing extinctions, in addition to human stresses, of course. Usually it's a 1-2 punch. But unlike, you know, the Ice Age films that I'm sure that most of us have seen or at least been forced to watch by our children or grandchildren, it's not the Ice Ages that cause extinctions. It's, in fact, the warming periods thereafter. And that's the really scary thing, because it's exactly the situation we're in now. Highly stressed planet already from human intervention and human endeavor that's rapidly heating. That is the perfect storm for extinctions.
So just to recap for listeners, rule one, during warming, the most ecologically important species go first. And rule two, global warming drives more species to extinction faster than global cooling. Are we good so far?
Yep, that's exactly right.
All right. Now, rule three, as I read it from your paper, is that during warming, plants tend to go extinct first. That seems counterintuitive. We're thinking, okay, the big animals are going to go first, but no?
Well, I mean, I'll ask your listeners to think about this. What's the one thing that plants generally can't do as well as animals?
Can't move.
Can't move. Yeah, exactly right. So because, I mean, they can disperse, obviously, through seed dispersal, and they can grow vegetatively and increase their distributions that way. But if things start to warm up, an animal just goes, well, this is uncomfortable. I'm going to move over there. And you can think about that over generational or even evolutionary timescales. Whereas a plant, it's a lot more restricted. Now, some plants are very good at that. Certain weedy species can disperse very quickly, and usually it's helped by an animal distributor. You know, for example, like a buzzy on a certain small plant can get stuck to the feathers of a bird, and it can fly a long way and distribute the species that way. But most plants really can't adapt that quickly. So if you get in a rapid warming scenario in particular, the local thermal tolerances are exceeded very quickly. And so what you get is an overall range contraction because they just can't keep pace with that change. If the change is really slow, and I think this is another thing people don't quite understand, is that it's not just the magnitude of the change, it's the pace of the change or the rate of the change that matters. And we're going through one of the most rapid warming events in the last 2.5 million years.
I graze Australian media, and I came across in the journal called The Conversation an article just published called An End to Endings, How to Stop More Australian Species Going Extinct. Are we losing a lot of creatures from that rare Australian ecosphere?
We are, unfortunately, the world leader in mammal extinctions. That is, we've had more extinctions in the last few hundred years than any other country in the world, for mammals, that is. We also have some of the highest declines in bird species, about 60% decline in total bird abundance over the last 50 years. We do have insect declines, but unfortunately not great data to show just how much. But, you know, we're seeing these extinction declines across the planet. Recent work from Germany and Puerto Rico has shown very disturbing declines in all sorts of insects. And these are, of course, the basis of the food web for most species. Birds eat them, reptiles eat them, and so on and so forth. So we're seeing a wholesale collapse of our ecosystems. And Australia is a kind of an extreme place already. Most of Australia is a desert, more or less. And we have this thin strip of vegetation sort of around the coasts. And we have a very delicate ecosystem. We've also lost almost more of our species over the last 50, 60,000 years than any other continent. We have very few large predators left. And we were on this knife edge. With increasing bushfires and droughts and cyclone intensity, as well as more and more development into very sensitive ecosystems, we're just kind of pushing all of that remaining wildness to the corners of the continent, and eventually it's all going to collapse.
And some of it just doesn't exist anywhere else, and we haven't even talked about marine extinction as more heat waves roll around the coast of Australia and around the world. Marine heat waves are a big new topic. Do your models include marine life, and does co-extinction play a strong role there?
It does indeed. In this particular set of models that we didn't really treat the marine environment simply because we have a different kind of thermal dynamic going on. Obviously, the specific heating capacity of water is quite different. However, I'm involved in several other projects that are showing the massive changes in the marine environment. For one, we're seeing our algae communities, our what we call macrophytes, so those that tend to be like the big kelps and things like that. We've seen wholesale shifts in communities by several degrees latitude over the last 40 or 50 years, especially on the east coast of Australia, because that's the East Australia current is quite strong. And these pulses of warm water are coming down more frequently and descending more into the south. So essentially, the algae community off of the coast of Tasmania now is what used to be off the coast of Sydney 50 years ago. But I was just in Sydney last week, in fact, involved in another project looking at the tropicalization of the fish communities off of Sydney. So we were in lovely Manly, the very wealthy neighborhood, diving in this beautiful little bay, seeing large blue grouper and Maori wrasse and all sorts of things. But what was really interesting is we were diving, we were seeing these little sergeant fish, these things with the most wonderful genus name, Abudefduff, that are essentially from the Great Barrier Reef, thousands of kilometers north, and they're showing up every year more and more. There are now over 60 tropical species found in Sydney that were never found there before the early 2000s. And so this rapid shift is happening in some ways much more quickly in the marine environment because things displace a lot more quickly.
You are listening to Radio Ecoshock. I'm Alex Smith from Australia. My guest is Dr. Corey Bradshaw from the Global Ecology Laboratory at Flinders University. So, Corey, within that concept of co-extinction, you portray different interdependent webs of life that help a lot of different creatures survive. But that interdependence also seems to offer a fragility that can bring the whole web down. Am I getting that right?
Yeah, so we ecologists often talk about things like functional redundancy. Now, that sounds like a fancy term, but essentially what it means is that there are different roles that different species play. For example, predators eat things, and plants photosynthesize, and certain things pollinate. And so everything has a specific role. Some things decompose dead flesh, and so on and so forth. So everything has a role, and there are certain species that do the same role. And we call this functionally redundant. I mean, every species has a slightly different niche. In other words, it exploits a slightly different component of its ecosystem. But that internal diversity and that functional redundancy is what gives ecosystems a certain shock-absorbing capacity. So they can take a disturbance and they can bounce back from it. Now, that only goes to a certain amount. So if you lose two or three species that have a similar functional role, the entire ecosystem can continue to function reasonably well. But the more species you lose from those functionally redundant roles, the more susceptible it becomes. And eventually, once the last species in that particular functional role goes, you can have a cascading effect right throughout the entire food web that affects almost everything else. So you can shock these systems, and that's an evolved trait as well. These systems evolve this capacity to withstand shocks because they've gone through them through evolutionary time. And the different components of these ecosystems shift in terms of what species are there at any particular time and over geological time, but the overall function is roughly the same. But if you push it too much, you get these mass extinction events. And we've had at least 6 mass extinction events in the past, probably more closer to 100 that we can measure through the fossil record. And it doesn't take a lot to push them. In fact, our model suggests that even a small change, well, small in the grand scheme of things, a 5-degree shift could see that most species in the world go extinct simply through this combination of exceeding the thermal tolerance as well as the extinction cascade. Now, that actually matches a lot of the sort of the order of magnitude temperature changes that we can infer from the fossil record for the great extinctions during the Permian and also probably the most infamous being the Cretaceous when the big asteroid hit the Earth and the dinosaurs went extinct. Well, no, sorry, they didn't go extinct. They turned into birds. But we lost the big ones. And so these wholesale planetary shifts are actually fairly easy to precipitate.
And you also say co-extinctions are often triggered well before the complete loss of an entire species, so that even oscillations in the population size of a species could result in the local disappearance of other species. How would that work, and how do you know that?
Well, so looking at an entire ecosystem, we tend to simplify it to particular nodes where we don't take the overall abundance, for example, or the spatial distribution of a species into account. But I do a lot of population ecology as well, and one of the truisms of extinction is what we call the small versus the declining population paradigm. So as a population declines, and it can decline for a number of reasons. It can decline because people are exploiting it, or it can decline because of a disease. It can decline for a whole host of reasons. That process generally then turns them into small populations. Now, small populations are susceptible to events that wouldn't really make much difference to a large population. For example, there's a great example I always used like to give is the great auk. The great auk was, I guess, the Northern Hemisphere's version of a penguin. It was hunted for its eggs and its flesh through much of the last 500 years. And it was it's a large penguin-like looking bird. It could fly modestly, but not very well. And it was super abundant throughout much of the last 500 years, throughout most of the North Atlantic and parts of the Pacific. And because of its popularity for eggs and meat, it was systematically hunted down to small population sizes. Now, the last remaining population was on a little islet off the coast of Iceland, I think sort of near the end of the previous century. The dates I don't have exactly in my head. But this small population didn't go extinct. This was the last population, so the species didn't go extinct because of all of the hunting. That particular islet blew up in a volcanic eruption, and that was it for the species. Now, that volcanic eruption, had it happened when the species was abundant and distributed over a large area, wouldn't have made much of a difference. So you get different processes operating. These random or what we call stochastic factors become very important as populations get small, and you can get them wiped out entirely. Or if you have massive fragmentation in space, so you only have a little population here, a little population there, then a predator, that, for example, that depends on those can't actually get to enough prey in time to be able to fulfill its own energy needs. And therefore, you can get, even though the extinction hasn't happened yet, it ceases to become, to do its functional role in the ecosystem, and therefore you get cascades well before the extinction.
But even if we don't get hit by an asteroid or a great chain of volcanoes doesn't explode, Am I getting from your paper that there's some sort of limit around 5 degrees centigrade warming where there could be the beginning of a biological end, at least of the species that we know and can see?
Yeah, and that, I think that was one of the shocking parts of this, is that it doesn't actually take as much as you would think. Now, 5 degrees in a lot of ways is unfathomable for most people, but we're already sort of exceeding the 2, perhaps even 3 component with little chance of backtracking there or avoiding that. So 5 isn't really out of the realms of possibility in terms of over the next few centuries. Now, to me, that just means that, you know, from these kinds of models and what we know about the fossil record, that we are pushing dangerously close to an extinction event that would, you know, certainly see our extinction, but probably most other species. Will life persist? Of course it will. Will there be species afterwards? Yes. But we might talk about millions of years of regeneration and speciation. The Earth will go on until, of course, the sun does blow up or something, you know, more extreme that removes all life. But humans won't be around. And I think it's, you know, my colleague often says this, you know, the Earth will survive. Human society probably won't. And that's what scares me.
That's the direction we're heading now, but we could make an extreme turn, perhaps, and rework our energy system and so on. But you also discovered that scientists have had a kind of bias towards optimism because they left out this co-extinction factor.
Yeah, and, you know, as I said, most of my colleagues weren't terribly surprised by this paper, but they're ecologists. But when you talk to the average person and you paint that picture, just, you know, it's a lot worse than even the pessimists think. And I'm, you know, I've been in this job too long not to be a pessimist, but even when I can shock myself with my own work, I know that I'm onto something that's probably scarier than most people even care to appreciate. So it's, we're getting into not just the, okay, there's a problem. This is a serious problem, and it's much, much bigger than most people can possibly realize. And we're starting to get political momentum, you know, school strike for climate and Extinction Rebellion and various other movements, but it's not nearly enough and not fast enough. And you know, the human population isn't going to go away anytime soon in terms of our population growth over the next 100 years or so. So if anything, we're going to see more damage and more problems before it gets any better. I strongly suspect we're going to have to go through a major population crash before we have any capacity to be able to reverse or at least slow down some of these negative trends.
You're not the first scientist to tell me that on Radio Ecoshock, but you do conclude that minimizing biodiversity loss is the best approach to preventing environmental collapse. Do we know how to save biodiversity?
Well, I think what we can do is probably, so the first thing is, of course, to do everything we can to limit the extent to which climate change is impacting the biosphere, but that's a political decision more than anything. I think in terms of smart management, this using models like these where we identify some of the most important species in those networks and putting more of our effort and our resources into saving those would be probably the smartest way to do it. So we're trying to maintain those strong functional roles within those ecosystems so that they can survive those shocks, those temperature shocks or those bushfire shocks or various other disturbances. So the more redundancy we have in the system, the more insurance we have. And that's, I think, what we have to focus on.
Mulling over your paper reminds me of that message so often printed on rearview mirrors. It says, objects may be closer than they appear, and it seems like the rules of extinction are almost hidden by the kind of consciousness that we have. We're very grasping. We think we know what's going on, but we don't. So I'm asking, did your study results stimulate new questions and concerns that you're now going to follow up on?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think a paper, most papers I write certainly generate more questions than they answer. That's just the reality of science. But yes, I'm certainly working on a lot of different kinds of network models now, both looking at past and future applications. So that's something that I've generated a lot of, you know, personal interest in. And I've got, you know, my entire lab is filled with people doing these sorts of things right now. So we're trying to get more of the complexity out of these systems just to identify which are the most important components that we need to keep around.
As we wrap up, tell us about your new science about the dingoes, the wild dogs of Australia.
Well, it's a paper that came out yesterday that just basically confirmed that the dingo is, in fact, a completely different species. It's in all respects, it's a native species of Australia and should be given protection because of it. But it's often considered just a wild dog that is vilified by especially the agricultural industry, and so it can be poisoned or shot or excluded with fencing. And we're just saying it deserves a very strong protection because it does play a very strong functional role in Australian ecosystems, and it needs to be protected if we want a chance of, again, increasing the resilience of the system. So that's generated a bit of controversy. I'm expecting to get some threats from people on email and online, but that's par for the course, really, in this business.
We've been speaking with Corey Bradshaw from the Global Ecology Lab at Flinders University in Australia. You can find links to all the science we've talked about in my show blog at ecoshock.org. Corey, thank you for sharing your time with us.
Thank you very much for your interest and questions.
I'm Alex Smith for Radio Ecoshock.
Check out the Radio Ecoshock website. We're at ecoshock.org.